because I've heard her speak several times, and I've been very impressed with her presentations, and I hope I'm sure my expectations will be filled again this time. She, of course, is no stranger to this part of the country. She has Freiburg level connections, and she is has been someone that has been scouring the landscape here for many years and has collected a lot of things which she's going to share with us hopefully tonight. She holds undergraduate and graduate degrees, MA and PhD from Harvard. She has lectured and published widely. She is active professionally and is currently president-elect of the American Folklore Society. And without further ado, I give you Joe Radner, who's going to speak on the topic, Performing the Paper, Village Learning and Laughter in Postbellum, Western Maine. Joe.
Once each week, weather permitting, and almost always permitted. Neighbors from as far as 10 miles away would get in their sleighs or on their horses or in their wagons, if you could go on wheels, and gather to witness or take part in a formal debate, usually held in the local one-room schoolhouse, at the local lyceum. This is not the lyceum of the urban Northeast, you know, where you had a distinguished speaker who was paid and a lecture series and so on. This was a homegrown intellectual venture in which the townspeople or the village people got together in their own homegrown debating societies. After the debate was over, there might be other presentations or declamations or musical offerings, but whatever else the local traditions called for, almost certainly one thing would happen. A woman would come forward to perform a public and well-appreciated reading of the paper. That was a handwritten literary newspaper that was produced by local women and filled with pieces composed by some of the assembled neighbors. It's these little community papers that I'm going to talk about tonight, what they were and what we can learn from them about their authors. Now, the editorial I just read was from one such paper, the Gazette, published and read aloud weekly by the South Bethel Debating Society. Other papers I've seen from Maine include Freiburg's Tollbridge Journal, the Kenduskeg Meteor, the VZ Light, the Beans Corner Sunbeam, which is from Jay, the South Levant Reading Club Independent, the Emden Center Times, the Mystic Tie from Weld, the Ladies Enterprise from Sweden, and then in New Hampshire, the Antrim Literary News, the Gem of the Valley from West Plymouth, the Pleasant Pond Transcript from Deerfield, the Poplin Herald from Fremont. And then just last week, over in Vermont, I saw the Monitor from East Cabot's Debating Club, and the Enterprise from West Danvers, and read about lots more that probably are in a dump somewhere. You notice that these are all produced in very small places, inland hamlets, not even towns. It was South Bethel, not the central part of town here. Tollbridge, which is that little hamlet nestled between the Saco River and the Lovell boundary, not bustling Freiburg Village. The phenomenon I'm looking at belonged to very rural farming neighborhoods, but it was widespread across all of northern New England. I didn't know that when I first started to look at these things. And as such, it has a lot to tell us about the postbellum state of mind in that area. I'm really excited that the Bethel Historical Society is embarking on a regional focus, because it seems to me this is the kind of phenomenon that points to a state of mind that really is, as far as I can tell, unique to northern New England. What I think maybe Mencken called Mooselandia. I haven't yet found it in Massachusetts or anywhere in the deeper south. None of the papers I've seen was mechanically printed. They were all handwritten, and there was usually just one copy per issue. A woman, who was designated everywhere the editress, encouraged her neighbors to write, both men and women, collected the pieces for the newspaper from them, arranged the pieces in a deliberate order and sometimes composed additional bits, and then wrote out a fair copy of the whole. And then, right after the Lyceum debate was finished, she or another woman would perform the paper. They would read that single copy aloud to the assembly. I brought a bunch of these papers here, or photocopies of them. I brought the South Bethel Gazette, the Beans Corner Sunbeam, the Poplin Herald, the Emden Center Times, and the VZ Light, and if you'd like to glance at these, please, my research depends on them, so put them back on the table, but if you'd like to look at them afterwards, you will see what very homegrown things they are. They aren't beautiful. They weren't to look at. They were to hear. Well, I asked myself after I realized that this wasn't just my great-grandmother's hobby, why would so many rural people, young and old, men and women, whose daily lives rarely, if ever, had anything to do with literature, respond so heartily to those papers' calls preface every public reading. The papers were produced with very high ambitions. According to an editorial in the Tollbridge Graphic from Freiburg, composing for the paper was a step, a personal gesture, within the reach of everyone toward reversing the decline of the modern world. Today, few, she wrote, will give up their life for the glory that will live after them. We want our rewards as we go along. This was 1870. And are angry if we do not get them. The love of literature, the cultivation of the taste for the beautiful, art and science are not common among us. How shall we begin to win back lost ground? How awaken the languishing interest and stir the smoldering ruins to living flame? Bring out the power lying dormant within us. Well, she said, it cannot be done in a year or many years even, but slowly and step by step, and these were the steps. There is no place of any size on earth but where there may be a literary circle. And how much better it would be to spend one's leisure hours in study than in idle gossip that drags downward all who become victims to its grasp. It's the little things that tell. Then begin with the little things. You say, I can't write a piece for the paper because I have no talent in that line. It is just what you ought to try to develop. A great writer said, demand virtue and you will have it. Demand taste for literature and you will obtain it. Well, virtue and literary creation are intertwined very closely here and publicly performed for the Lyceum audience, whose object, according to one of the Freiburg editresses, is to hear the eloquence of our Tollbridge debaters and listen to the able productions of Tollbridge contributors to the journal. The papers had a very solemn function. We aim to do good and to make our paper instructive as well as amusing. We hope to speak some word that may cheer some desponding brother or sister, that may give them courage for the battle of life. If we are able to do this, we shall feel satisfied. Well, eavesdropping on these Lyceums more than a century later, this high sense of purchase, but purpose, seems to me to jostle pretty oddly against the contents of these Lyceum papers. Humor. Humor of all sorts is the rule in these. There are some sober moral essays, virtue, men's vanity, thoughts on time. And there are high-minded and sentimental poems like Ode to Night and Oh, Look Not Down Upon the Graves and that sort of thing. But in most of the papers, those serious pieces are in a minority. And in fact, in the South Bethel paper, there aren't any, which is probably why I decided it'd be appropriate to talk about humor with you all tonight. There's this humorous matrix of jokes and punning rhymes and teasing conundrums and parodies of journalistic genres and political oratory and comic poems, mock biblical prophecies and parodies, and even forged selections from alleged personal diaries. proportions vary, as I say, but why did this motley array of wit play such a prominent role in papers intended, as their editresses put it, to foster those influences which make men better and to prove profitable to both their authors and their audiences, much less to retrieve the world from a vast cultural decline? What can we learn from these papers about the relationship between humor, self-improvement, and the culture of Northern New England a century ago? Well, one few fruitful approach to that question is to consider what the humor was about. Some of it concerned national, state, and regional issues, politics, economics, temperance. Though the papers all featured serious pieces on topics like that, Does Farming Pay, entry in New Hampshire Literary News, 1885, or The Value of the Press, well, 1875, was a fair amount of tongue-in-cheek political commentary. Mr. Fred Farrington, while in Saco recently, was mistaken for a member of the last legislature and arrested. He was charged with burglary, conspiracy, embezzlement, sedition, and false pretenses. I guess if it had been nowadays, the list would have been longer and a little different. The same journal parodies the language of temperance debates with an essay called The Gum Question, lamenting the ravages of gum chewing and deploring the evolution of a nation of gum arts. In creating pieces like this, you know, the writers authorized themselves to make ironic comments on very large national topics of the time. And they were making a very strong and very direct claim. They might live in small villages, but they were not backwater bumpkins. They were active and responsive citizens in a democracy. Humor is power. Much of the rest of the humor in the papers dealt with local people and events. No farmer who made a blunder could escape public notice. At a minimum, there might be a news report like this one from South Bethel. J.M. Kennison has swapped horses with Alton Coffin and gave his horse and $50 for an aged specimen about 75 without any sound legs and no body of any use. But bowling on a larger scale was apt to inspire more extensive flights of imagination. Off, too. It's warm tonight, isn't it? When prominent Freiburg farmers who should have known better purchased diseased hogs that subsequently died, the inventive paper writers at Tollbridge responded with five strategically scattered pieces in the next Tollbridge Journal. There's a brief news item headlined, "No Certainty in Hogs," and a notice of a forthcoming scientific lecture on hogology, which concludes, "John F. Hobbs is respectfully requested not to be present as he might consider the subject personal." A long mock biblical epistle of John to the people of Toll Bridge, narrating the melancholy history whereby was fulfilled the prophecy, the desolation of the pig pen spoken of by the prophet John. Mock recipe for soap making, ridiculing the economics of buying a sick pig solely for its lard, and a closing narrative poem, probably by the editors, bringing together the various laughable local events of the past week. Again, we can see that this public teasing served an important community function. It dealt with potentially irritating local issues in a way that was doubly buffered, both by humor and by being transformed into art. Gossip couldn't fester nearly so well when its subject had already become a much appreciated communal performance. Instead of being ostracized by shame, the blunderers were drawn back into the social circle as chastened but cherished stars of a public production. In the same way, local eccentrics got institutionalized in the papers. A great curiosity. There is a great curiosity at South Bethel, which attracts everyone far and near, especially the ladies. This is a living encyclopedia, the only specimen found in this country. 'Tis an ungainly looking object, somewhat resembling a gorilla, but possessing the organs of a human being. The amount of food it consumes is most extraordinary. It has been known to eat with great gusto 9 quarts of baked beans, 5 pounds of pork, 4 loaves of brown bread, 29 and a half donuts, and 7 pumpkin pies at one meal, but what surprises everyone most is its ability to answer the most difficult questions, thus manifesting remarkable brain power. It can tell the definition and pronunciation of every word in the English language, explain the Bible from first to last. In fact, as far as wisdom goes, Seth Solomon has to take a back seat on account of this strange biped, whose common name is Columbus Kimball. Don't know Columbus Kimball. Anybody have any recollection or are there any stories about this fellow?
There's a Columbus Kimball in Bryant Pond.
Well, he's undoubtedly a relative. Whether he wants to know it or not.
Less.
Now, then as now, eccentric people were a boon to small villages. The paper writers loved them. Eccentrics provide the village with a standing joke, and they become institutions whose oddities could be depended on for amusement. And the tone of all the pieces about them is very affectionate and accepting. You know, furthermore, the case of a maverick like Columbus Kimball, or like what I imagine Columbus Kimball to have been, points to yet another function of the public humor in a small community. It was an equalizer. characterizing him as an ungainly, ravenous living encyclopedia produced the threat a good deal. The humor and irony of the papers also enabled the few local men who had unusual levels of education, like lawyers and doctors, to take part in the community gatherings if they wished. They just had to join in the game of wit and cut themselves down to size with self-deprecating humor, and they were well appreciated. So already you can see several functions of the humor of the Lyceum papers. The humor helped the community claim cosmopolitan knowledge. It took the sting out of local blunders, and it reached out to include a diverse range of neighbors in the intellectual and social circle. It also promoted moral behavior. Several of the papers, for instance, report married men caught in compromising situations. This is the best. I don't know if I have time to read the whole thing, but I'd love to. A startling incident. South Bethel was thrown. Sorry to keep focusing on South Bethel. There seemed a relevance somehow, and it was a juicy little paper. South Bethel was thrown into a state of excitement last week. He sent it to me. Owing to an unsuccessful attempt of a prominent citizen to elope with a married lady. This was J.G. Abbott, residing on Sand Street of this city, and his companion was Mrs. Lecty Goodwin of Milton. They named names. Formerly from this place. Tuesday evening, Mr. Abbott seemed strangely agitated and appeared more than usually absent-minded, as Mrs. Abbott states that upon coming in that evening, he actually hung his hat up. A thing he has never before been known to do. Somewhat alarmed at this, Mrs. Abbott narrowly watched her husband during tea and observed that he ate only 4 or 5 biscuits, a few cookies, etc., and that his appetite was certainly very poor. He then started, as she supposed, for a committee meeting. But in fact, he wound up with Mrs. Goodwin. And they started off. When halfway to Bethel Hill Corner, the horse became frightened at something by the roadside, and Mr. Abbott, being unable to restrain him, having only one hand not engaged, they were both thrown violently from the wagon, and the horse, freeing himself from the shafts, ran home. A passerby soon noticed the mishap and set about to release the unfortunate couple, who were struggling to regain their equilibrium but were unsuccessful as the wagon and its contents were topmost. Upon finding herself free, the lady took to her heels, leaving only one thing that betrayed her identity. This was a dental plate set with 2 teeth in front, which were thrown from her mouth at the time of the disaster. Mr. Abbott was injured. I have to read the whole thing. I can't help that. Mr. Abbott was injured about the skull and has slowly been recovering his senses ever since. Much to the satisfaction of his wife. It is stated upon good authority that as there was a box of eggs in the wagon, the unhappy prepare presented a striking symphony in yellow at the time of rescue. This is the second mishap Mr. A has experienced in trying to manage the horse with his dexter hand. Moral: don't try to do 2 things at once. Wanted: a wife, one that can cook, wash, mop, dress deer, and skin foxes. Elmer Berry. And a page later, wanted, a physician as housewife, can cook and dress all kinds of game, should prefer a hunter, as I am very fond of wild meat. Bell meat. That's from the Emden Center Times in 1893. But here's a notice from East Bethel, in case you thought I was favoring the South too much. Lost and found. Lost on the road between Bean's Corner and Middle Interval. A young man's heart. Anyone returning the same to the subscriber will be swiftly rewarded. Fred Howe, Kimball Hill, December 4th, 1877. Near the residence of J.D. Hastings, an article resembling a human heart. The owner can have the same by proving property and paying charges. The papers broadcast rumors about who was sweet on whom, you know, through a huge variety of genres. You know, conundrums, versified wills, alphabetical verses, echo poems, mock song titles, parody marine news, which is my favorite because all of these were inland villages, and so forth. They gave impetus to the reluctant or the bashful that way, and they let the observant ones test out the possibilities. What kind of a dog does our organist prefer? A barker, of course. Which book in the New Testament is interesting to a certain young lady? The book of James. Those are from Tollbridge in the 1890s. The Lyceum papers presented courting as the means to settled marriage. There were accepted rules, therefore. For young people as for older, public teasing, as the paper was read aloud, could correct behavior. Norris Kennerson and Rose Goodwin are giving free lessons in modern courtships at all our public entertainments. Come to our lyceums and learn how to court by the improved method. Young men were teased about flitting from woman to woman. Girls were obliquely rebuked for coquetry. In 1875, for instance, the mystic Tye up in Weld carried a sketch from Etta's diary, no doubt forged, in which Etta revels in the memory of a week spent tormenting her beaux. The difficulties of courting generated a lot of literary effort. There are a few successes. For example, the sweet poem in which a young man tells the story of going berry picking on the hill with Nellie Grover. This is uphill work, said Nellie. So is life, said I. Shall we climb it each alone, or Nellie, will you come and climb with me? Redder than the blushing berries, Nellie's cheeks one moment grew. Then without delay, she answered, I will go and climb with you. But for the most part, calamities, which then as now make the best press, are the norm. Boys are pilloried for clumsiness or bashfulness. For stories of wooing disasters, the ballad was the genre of choice, sometimes put into the mouth of the unfortunate suitor himself. Poor Sam in Freiburg went courting, was told by the girl to leave, and suffered the rewards of clumsiness. In my various avocations, in my past pursuits of life, my neighbors talked of nothing else but getting me a wife. But now they talk of my bad luck, as I am well aware how up to Mr. Walker's I tumbled down the stairs. In Kenduskeg, in 1884, poor Willie Watson tried for 12 stanzas to find a girl willing to go skating with him. But Willie's rather bashful, so many times he's been refused. He don't think it's just fair the way that he's been used. The prospect of long-term failure in courting was dreadful. Bachelors, always presented as men who were too inept to get wives, not as men who preferred not to marry, are teased mercilessly. Elias Gould of Bean's Corner in Jay is too nervous to propose to one of the fairest of Earth's creatures. He begs sympathy for his deep afflictions and laments that I've no match made in heaven, and I must drag out my natural term of life in a dreary state of loneliness and without a lovely better half. Sad, but how true, and yet how different it might have been. In their neighbor, Hiram Kelsey Hobbs, the Tollbridge Journal writers created an archetypal scapegoat bachelor. In 1871, when he was 33, the journal carried supposed extracts from a week of Kelsey's diary. On Monday, he laments, "I can't endure the tortures of a single life much longer, and what's more, I won't." And he sets off day by day to propose to and be turned down by a different woman, promising on Friday that if he fails once more, "I will next week go to Boston to be a conductor on a railway car." 20 years later, he was still the butt of the journal's jokes. Hiram Kay says he would like to have the women vote if one of them would only vote to marry him. The paper's treatment of unmarried older women is far more delicate. There's no personal teasing, but there are cautionary pieces. Women who flirt and do not choose promptly among their suitors may well be sentenced to a single life. Dorcas Cushman of South Bethel is imagined in her old age later on, thinking back regretfully to her youth when she could count her suitors by the score, and realizing that now only Spiller, the blacksmith Grimm, is left unmarried. "Rather than die an old maid, I declare I'll marry him." Well, the message of these comic pieces is very clear. Young people should marry soon, and they should marry local. Warnings to women who might wish to move to the cities were unambiguous, as in the VZ Light essay signed with an absolutely audacious alias, "Gay Spanker," advising VZ girls to stop simpering or playing the fool to some brainless mustached fox in the parlor. "Better set your cap for that young farmer or river driver at whom you have nearly died a laughing so many times. Go to work and be no longer the contempt of all the smart, active, go-ahead, marriageable young men in VZ." Men, too, are warned to marry local, though the warnings are more oblique. In an 1877 issue of the Sunbeam, there appears a letter which is dated 1890, that is 13 years in the future, from a local young man who has chosen to leave Bean's Corner to seek his fortune. Not only has he found no fortune, but after a short and pleasant courtship of 2 months, he has married a widow who was represented to me as being very wealthy, but I soon found out all her wealth consisted of a family of 9 children. Know the people you're going to marry. Meanwhile, business has been flourishing in Bean's Corner, and those who have stayed there, and the Lyceum, in which the letter writer says he has ever felt the deepest interest, are enjoying prosperity. Marry local. Well, from some angles of vision, asserting the viability of rural New England villages after the Civil War was a courageous venture. As we know, the late 19th century was an era that was marked by economic challenge and change for the traditional ideals of family farming that were valued by older communities in the northern New England area. More and more young people were leaving those settled rural communities for the frontier or the industrial cities. The pull to move away was absolutely enormous. In Freiburg and Lovell, for instance, the area that included the writers of the Tollbridge Journal, between 1860 and 1890, the population declined by 23%. And you have to think that that was at a time when the population of the United States doubled. That statistic is pretty dramatic. For those who chose not to leave the farming villages of northern New England, those who stayed behind, as the historian Hal Barron has named them, handwritten newspapers, humorous as they often were, performed quite serious functions. The underlying mission of the village editresses was nothing less than cultural preservation. They expressed and taught and help to maintain a consistent set of expectations and attitudes, among which the celebration of female domesticity, local matchmaking, and marriage was a key element. Realizing this brought me to another question about the rural Lyceum papers. Why? Why in an era when travelers and lecturers and the popular press brought news of women's commercial employment and women's political and social activism to even the most remote rural areas, why were the editors so willing to produce papers that pushed women toward exclusively domestic and local goals? To answer that one, have to look more closely at what the rural women gained from producing and performing the Lyceum papers. They gained an unparalleled opportunity to participate and to wield power in the public intellectual life of the community. In rural neighborhoods, patriarchy had many provinces, and women's voices were unwelcome in most of them. Not only were politics, law, and medicine male bastions, but women's access to informal public venues of discussion was a lot more restricted than men's. Typically, for instance, gatherings around the wood stove in stores, and what town didn't have those, were exclusively male. John Hobbs of Lovell wrote a comic essay describing the local village store conversation group as the Lovell Court of Law. He caricatures the men who hung out there as the chief justice, judges, and attorneys of the backstore court, including himself as one of the leading members of the bar. He was, in fact, a lawyer. He didn't mean lawyers. Tongue always in cheek, he wrote about the importance of the court to the town. He said, "We need two physicians in this place, and we have them. No matter which one you employ, before you die, you will wish you had had the other. We need a good minister, and we have one. We need a good minister's wife, and we have her. But over and above all, we need that court of law to settle law points, adjudicate quarrels, decide trades, and to harmonize and regulate community. That court, although it grinds slow, yet it grinds exceeding small." Despite Hobbes' well-honed irony, his final point has a serious side. A long-standing traditional social institution like that backstore gathering is important to harmonize and regulate community. But Hobbes is explicit that not everyone was included among the harmonizers and regulators. No women are allowed to attend. If a woman has any matter to come before the court, she must appear by attorney. I do not know the reason of this rule, except that the Chief Justice says he won't have them around. Hobbes was well aware of the irritant power of this exclusion. For some unaccountable reason, the ladies of this village, perhaps because they are not allowed to practice, look with disfavor upon this court and stigmatize its business, its important business, as loafing, and its hard mental labor, harder than sprouting potatoes, beating carpets, putting up stove funnels, and making soap, as idleness. Well, what were the women missing? What they would have gained by practicing in the backstore court was not just relief from domestic chores. Like most such institutions, the Lovell backstore provided a kind of sociable public forum for discussion of the affairs of the town and the state and the country. It was a visible and centrally located gathering, and it was an authoritative vehicle of community opinion, still is here and there. It also provided the stage for oratory and wit, an arena for humorous repartee, and even a setting for literature, because some of the attorneys at the bar actually entertained the group by declaiming their own compositions. Well, in the 19th century, literacy and orality, that is, writing and public speaking, were strongly intertwined. Historically, American women had been excluded from both. Before the Revolution, women were typically taught to read, but with the exception of a very few upper-class women, they were not taught to write. But as William Gilmore has written, one of the central developments of the 19th century was the increasing intellectual emancipation of ordinary American women. Female elocution texts first appeared in the 19th century, designed to teach women the arts of reading aloud pleasantly and effectively. And by the end of the century, thanks to common schools and female academies, the literacy rates for men and women were equalized. Rural women were ready to take part in the intellectual life of the community, and the Lyceum Papers offered them that opportunity as little else did. Each woman, when the job of editress came to her, exerted public power over the community. She convinced her neighbors, whether or not they saw themselves as writers, to create pieces for the paper. Once she collected the pieces, she decided which ones would be included in the paper. So she had a direct effect on the self-esteem of the contributors, male and female. And then she put her own spin on the papers by determining the order of the pieces, and if she wanted to, by composing other pieces of her own. In some villages where the position of editress rotated weekly or fortnightly, the editress herself would perform the public reading. In other areas, the editress had a longer term, but other women took turns doing the reading. They practiced for it. It was elocution. In either case, the Lyceum Papers spoke for the community in a woman's voice. The paper reading gave gender balance to the Lyceum evening. Most of the debaters were male. The paper readers were female. The debate was a male political event. The paper was a female literary enterprise. So in their verbal cleverness, and their community focus, and their public rhetoric, the village Lyceum Papers had some similarity to the court of law. Like conversation and oratory in the backstore court, the Lyceum Papers were witty, but because they were more public, their jokes and their revelations of local events were more risky, and therefore they were buffered by containment in a formal structure, the public reading of anonymous written texts by a reader who was not necessarily the author of the pieces she was reading. Only the editress knew who the individual authors were. Imagine. Some of you have written scurrilous pieces about some others. I'm the reader. I know who's written what. You don't know whose victim you are. That was the dynamics of these evenings. She concealed their identity from the rest of the gathering by making a fair copy of the entire paper in her own handwriting before the Lyceum met. So the editress was doubly powerful. She controlled not only the messages that were going to be sent out, but also the knowledge of whose messages they were. And because the gender of the authors was also concealed by this system, women writers would have had an unusual freedom of topic and expression. They could, for instance, write on political or economic issues that were normally considered the province of men. So, just to wrap this all up before you melt, the Lyceum evenings offered women a strong voice in the community and a share in the pleasures of witty public repartee and an opportunity to mix with men as intellectual equals. That wasn't common. It's clear that women had a major stake in the survival of these villages. And their papers placed village survival first and foremost, no matter what price they had to pay. No matter what the backstore courts of law might decree, through these little papers, female influence reached the town, and a different and authoritative force was on hand to harmonize and regulate.
That's the absolute end. I found nothing later than that.
And what seemed to happen, the latest papers that I have so far found, I think come from 1895 in Freiburg. And what happened there was that the debates, I think, but certainly the papers, were transferred to the Freiburg Center Grange and became its literary program as soon as it was established. So that's as late as they have. The earlier part, I have different ideas about every day. But, yes?
Well, tell us some of the ideas that you have.
Well, you have no idea how frustrating this research is. Something that looks like this, I think no matter how long I do this research, I'm going to keep on finding things that change my ideas, because I'll never have enough to speak authority. I think that one answer to when the tradition began, if that was your question, is that it was always available, because newspapers were an available activity. Making a homemade newspaper was fun. Kids did it. They did it in Little Women. That spawned a lot of other kids doing it, and so on. But back before then, the making of handwritten newspapers tended to happen in high schools. And sometimes in associations like Christian associations, Sunday schools, that sort of thing. The model, since a lot of young people took part in the newspapers, I suspect that their models came out of schools originally. But the phenomenon is really very different, because the newspapers spoke, these Lyceum papers spoke for the whole community. They weren't the East Bethel paper that Stan gave me pieces of, and haven't found the whole thing yet. But that one, from the content, is pretty clear the school paper. There are some verses about the teacher. It's all more or less student work. But it's very light in all these genres, the ones that the older people did. So the real innovation that somebody did somewhere in the middle of the century was to use these as a community institution.
Other questions or comments?
I know it's not the season for it, but I want you all to go home and check your attics. Let me know if you have odd poetry or places there. Yes. I have two articles that will be coming out but haven't yet. There's a book coming out sometime the end of this year, if we're lucky, from the University of Maine Press on women in Maine history, edited by Polly Coffin. And there'll be a piece in there. And then there'll be a piece in the Northeast Folk Life later on this year.
Anything similar other regions of the world?
Really startled. The internet does amazing things. About a year and a half ago, I got a query from a Finnish scholar who was working on Finnish immigrants to the United States who had created handwritten newspapers. And they were in Finnish. And this scholar sent me a couple of papers, and I sent him or her, I wasn't quite sure from the name, a couple of things that I had written. But that's the widest spread in the world, I know. I think what I would like to know, but I haven't yet found anything, is whether they occurred in the Maritimes. That would make sense, but I don't know. Do you know? Or anywhere in Atlantic Canada. Or whether they occurred anywhere else along the frontier. I think that the particular configuration of events in northern New England may have meant that they were just here in this form. from the 1850s, telling all kinds of fascinating stories about what was going on in Portland society. And it was made up like a newspaper was written out, and I didn't know who on earth could be circulating those stories. And then I realized when I finally read to the end of one of the issues that the writer was creating a newspaper, but it was really a way of sending news to his brother who was employed in Shanghai. It was a very private.
Interesting.